All buildings must comply with relevant normative documentation. However, in the context of the Applied Facade Engineering course, when we discuss compliance as a design principle, we refer to the strategies for achieving and, equally importantly, demonstrating that both the design and the resulting construction meet statutory requirements and the set performance parameters for the building. Our focus is on the building in London, which is subject to UK building regulations. The UK government offers guidance on how to meet these regulations through approved documents. Take, for instance, approved document B, which addresses the fire safety in buildings. By adhering to the guidance in this document, we ensure fire stops are placed in the gaps between the concrete frame and the internal compartment forming elements, such as floor slabs and party walls. This document also stipulates the minimum acceptable material performance based on their reaction to fire, referring to European standard for classification of materials reaction to fire. Based on this guidance, we select materials suitable for external walls. With our building exceeding 18 meters in height, we are limited to the using of materials rated A2S1D0 or better. This restriction eliminates many high-performance insulating materials, leaving mineral wool as the most feasible option for this building. While there are other insulating materials on the market that could meet this requirement, their use on a large scale tends to be cost prohibitive. There are exceptions to the ban on combustible materials in external walls, such as membranes, sealants, and thermal bricks. However, mass timber used as primary framework is not one of them. For this reason, it is prudent to position mass timber columns and shear walls away from the building's perimeter to prevent their inclusion in the external wall construction. It is worth mentioning that this fire safety requirement does not appear to be applicable in all countries. For instance, the world's tallest timber frame building located in Norway, which serves as a hotel, incorporates timber not only in its primary framework, but also in its rainscreen cladding. This construction could be compliant with Norwegian building standards, but would be virtually impossible to replicate in the UK due to local building codes. When selecting systems for building design, designers should anticipate challenges not only in achieving compliance, but also in selecting the path of least resistance for demonstrating compliance. For the opaque walls in the retrofitting strategy that incorporates a timber frame with balcony serving as a buffer zone between the external screen and the primary structure, two facade types are worth considering: the stick curtain wall and the rainscreen cladding on the lightweight steel frame. Let's explore why the curtain wall might be a more feasible option for achieving and demonstrating compliance. With the rainscreen cladding approach, to avoid the inclusion of timber frame within the facade zone, the lightweight steel frame would need to extend beyond the slab edge. In such scenario, L-shaped brackets could be installed at the slab edge, to which galvanized steel studs would be attached. These studs would be covered with a sheeting board supporting breather membrane and insulation. Bridging the gap between the slab and the sheeting board would require a proprietary fire-stopping system. However, filling the voids in the C-shaped studs with a proprietary fire-stopping system presents a challenge. Crafting a solution for this junction is conceivable, but likely to stray from the standard certified and tested application of fire-stopping system. This deviation introduces a hurdle in the path of demonstrating compliance. This issue does not arise with a curtain wall facade. In this configuration, it's feasible to use proprietary fire stop between the slab and the spandrel area backing pan, a solution that has been tested and certified. Secondly, the balcony stop bracket would be viewed as a penetration through the rainscreen assembly's ventilated cavity. According to the guidance of the approved document B, this penetration should be compartmentalized by cavity barriers around the bracket. However, installing these barriers would inevitably pierce the membrane around the bracket, requiring strict installation quality control measures to maintain the watertightness of this detail and ensure appropriate water and air tightness. Conversely, the penetration of the bracket through the spandrel panel of the stick curtain wall does not necessitate additional compartmentation measures, since it lacks ventilated cavity, making it a sealed facade. Given that the balconies encircle the entire perimeter of the building, rendering this detail highly repetitive, enhancing buildability and the practicality of execution of this interface significantly simplifies achieving and demonstrating compliance. Therefore, in this scenario, opting for stick curtain wall facade makes practical sense. When discussing balconies, it's important to note the standards set by British Standard Institution, or BSI, which produces documents that provide clarifications and guidelines for compliance with building regulations. One such standard is BS 8579, released relatively recently. This standard offers guidelines on safety and performance considerations in balconies design. According to this British standard, balcony surfaces should be slip-resistant, a requirement that has gained importance following the recent ban on combustible materials. This ban has led to exclusion of timber and composite decking for balconies in tall buildings, making it crucial for designers to consider alternative materials like metal surfaces with micro-ribs especially if using aluminium decking. The standard also addresses balustrade geometry, advising designers to avoid designs that include level surfaces on handrails, where objects such as ashtrays and drinks could be placed, presenting hazard to the people below. Furthermore, the British standard suggests the balcony design should include measures to prevent objects from rolling off balconies' pedestrian surfaces, enhancing safety of the public below the balconies. It also clarifies the types of drainage systems that are permissible on balconies based on their size and geometry. We will discuss this in more detail in parts of Façade module when talking about balconies. When it comes to selection of glass, building regulations don't prescribe which type of glass is to be used and where. One will not find toughened or laminated glass to be directly mandated by building regulations. The industry tends to rely on ancillary guidance documents issued by trade bodies and independent research and publishing organizations like Center for Window and Cladding Technology, or CWCT, and Construction Industry Research and Information Association, or CIRIA. For example, the guidance on glazing at height is a good example of third-party normative document, which designers commonly use when creating a risk analysis for selecting type of glasses on the project depending on their location on the building, its geometry, level of exposure to building occupants and public, and many other considerations. We will talk about this in more detail in the materials section of the course when we talk about glass. Designers may need to adhere to additional normative documents based on the procurement route and the building's intended use. For instance, in residential buildings, the design team might have to comply with standards set by warranty providers like National House Building Council or NHBC and Local Authority Building Control or LABC. Both organizations issue their own standards, which are often more stringent than building regulations. For example, NHBC standards may require cavity barriers to be placed at shorter intervals than guidance in approved document B suggests, and impose stricter requirements for managing condensation risk through more rigorous boundary conditions. A building owner might opt for voluntary certification through Building Research Establishment Environmental Assessment Method, or BREEAM. This choice significantly influences the selection of materials and the procurement route for the project. The design team will be required to collect evidence to demonstrate compliance across various BREEAM assessment categories, including energy, water use, materials, waste, pollution, health and well-being, land use, ecology, and transport. For example, compliance with BREEAM metrics could be important when selecting glasses. As we will see in the materials section when discussing use of laminated and monolithic glass, it will become clear that laminated glass will be a safer option and in most instances perform better acoustically. However, laminated glass is more challenging to recycle than monolithic. BREEAM encourages the use of materials that, among other factors, are sustainably sourced and have lower environmental impact over their life cycle, including end-of-life disposal and recycling. From a sustainability standpoint, the use of monolithic toughened glass will be a favorable option. As you can see, demonstrating compliance could be a balancing act, and it's worth considering the use of monolithic toughened glass, providing that it is safe to do so. Here, the guidance on glazing at height by CIRIA, which we have mentioned earlier, could help determine the safe areas of application of monolithic glass. For example, in the inner panes of the glazing units of the windows, or even external panes of glasses and balconies, providing that the risk of breakage is deemed to be low, and in case of breakage, the pieces of glass will not pose hazard to public below. Clients such as hotel chains may have their own standards that go beyond general building regulations. For instance, they might require glazing with more demanding acoustic parameters than those specified in approved document E, which covers resistance of passage of sound. The members of design teams such as facade consultants may set even stricter requirements for the project design. Also, it's not uncommon for the project's facade consultant to require compliance with foreign normative documents in the absence of relevant European or British standards. For example, the designers practicing in the UK tend to use local French norm as a basis for determining the maximum admissible stress within glass. Furthermore, the building's design team must demonstrate competence in both design and execution specific to the project to comply with the Building Safety Act. This underscores the importance of the educational initiatives like the courses we offer at the Institute of Architectural Science and Technology, which aim to support industry in meeting these challenges.
This video is part of the Retrofit case study by the Institute for Architectural Science and Technology. Now it's time to check your understanding of this tutorial. Visit iast.uk to take a quiz and explore interactive 3D models. Each question includes a custom visual and a detailed explanation. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel and leave your comments below. Thank you for watching.